Come on, somebody. Well, anyone glad they came to church today? I'm so glad I came to church today. So good. We're so glad that you came to church this morning, and we don't believe it's a coincidence you're here. We're so glad that you came to church. I'm convinced that church is better because you're in it. You're the reason why we do it, and we want to say there's a seat at our table. If you didn't know that, there's a seat at our table, and we're so glad that you're here. My name's Dino, for those of you I haven't had the privilege of meeting yet, and myself and my wife, Kelly, it's our privilege to serve you as we lead this church, and we're excited to share God's word with you. We're in our very first week. If this is your first week with us, we're starting a brand new series called Relationship Goals, and we're going to have a good old time. I want to let you know that these next 4 weeks, we're going to have a great time in church. Church should be enjoyed and not endured. Can I have a good amen? And so we're going to have a great time. So whatever your relational status, single, it's complicated, entanglement, sherbet. Now that's the difference. We'll pray for entanglement. You feel entangled. We'll lift you before the Lord as well. Anyway, we'll talk to our worship team about their relationships after the service. Said the newly married woman. Just saying her first description of her, entangled. You just got married like a couple months ago. Anyway, but maybe you are single. We're going to help you out this next 4 weeks with some good old pickup lines. I've decided to release my first book, How to Get Dating as a Christian. Let's go. Hope, are you ready? First thing you want to do is after the service, you want to have a smolder. Just a holy smolder. It said that Moses was glowing when he came down from the mount because he had been in the presence. You just got to have that holy glow. You got to raise your left hand real high in worship, standing in the front row over here so people know I'm available, but I love the Lord. You got to walk over to our connect area and don't leave straight away after the service. You got to say, hey, beautiful, you're a 9 out of 10 and I'm the one you're looking for. Come on, somebody. Come on, that'll preach. I just want to help some people here today. Hey, I've looked through the book of Numbers, but I haven't found yours. Oh, come on. I put the stud in Bible study. Oh, we're going to have a good old time. Put some anointing oil on. Go to View Group. Open up your Bible. Make sure it's highlighted. And just sit there at View Group with a highlighted Bible. Just go, I still think the best strategy going forward to find someone in this day and age is to buy 2 Bourvoir's rolls, stand by a fan, and see who you attract. Just let that, the ambience, just see who comes by the, I think that was a good strategy for me. So the book is going to be released at the end of the series. So hopefully that you'll support your pastor as he releases his first piece of literature, How to Get Dating as a Christian. Amen. That being said, there are some disclaimers to this series that I just wanted to, here's the fine print. Here we go. You ready for this? You got to really zoom in for this guy. Don't just say accept, because you know, it just pops up on the screen. Ah, accept. I've read the disclaimers are that some things I may say may sound weird, may sound extreme, even abnormal, but I promise you, you don't want normal. I don't want normal, because normal is broken, baggaged, hurt, disenfranchised. And normal is not what we want. I want to say that normal is not what God wants for your life. We don't want normal. So some of the things I may say in this series may offend you, but it's okay. It's for the guy next to you, not for you then. If it offends you, it's for the person behind you that was singing so loud in your ears. You say, come on, man. I want to say that this series, I'm probably going to be very, very clear because I want to be very, very kind. To be clear is to be kind, because the more the clarity, the deeper the conviction. The less the ambiguity, the more certain your steps. I want to make sure that you are confident in when you're following Jesus. As followers of Christ, that you're walking in His best for your life. And so we're going to find out what the Word says, what the Bible says about how do we treat people? How do we approach relationships? And I want to tell you what, God's going to do 3 things in your life in this month. In our church, He's going to do 3 things. Maybe one more than the other. I'm guessing probably all 3. He's going to do 3 things. He's going to heal you from your past. He's going to equip you in your presence. And He's going to prepare you for your future. He's going to do that. If you would open your door of your heart and your mind for this month, and you're saying, Lord, I want you to speak into my life. He's going to do this. He's going to heal you from your past. He's going to equip you for what you're facing in your present, and he's going to prepare you for your future. But you first need to make the decision, hey, I'm going to let him in. I'm going to allow him to speak into my life. And so that's what we're going to do now. We're just going to take a moment, and I want you to pray. You can take a horse to the water, come on, but you can't make it. You can't make a drink. We've got something prepared for you today, but only you can decide to partake. You can be in the building, hey, but are you in this place? Let's just pray, and I want to ask you to ask God to speak to you today. Come on, let's pray as we receive God's word. Lord, we thank you that you are here. We thank you that you're speaking, that you love us, that you're for us. Lord, I first want to just lift anyone here before you, God, that feels a bit anxious, a bit worried about the future, maybe even disappointed or deferred, feels a little lost. God, I thank you that they're in their Father's house right now. Their Father loves them. He's been looking for them. He's so glad that they're here. Lord, I pray that you would encourage them, build them up, lead them with your Spirit, empower them with your Word. I pray they find community in your house. And Lord, I pray today would give you all the glory and all the honor in Jesus' precious name. And all God's people said, amen. Okay, well, repeat after me. Everyone say, I am on a journey. I am on a journey. You're on a journey, and maybe the person next to you is on a journey. You know that, so you're just like, you're on a journey. You are on a journey. So whether you're single, complicated, dating, engaged, married, or divorced, whatever your relational status is, we are believing for these three things: healing for the past, equipping for the present, and preparing for the future. Okay? And we are going to believe God that in these next 4 weeks, God is going to give you the tools and the keys to take your next step with him. Everyone's on a journey, so no one's arrived. It's not about being in or out, it's about the direction you're walking. What's the point of sprinting in the wrong direction? I'm saying we're on a journey here, and I want to invite you to be part of this journey for the next 4 weeks. Next week, we've got Mads Daisel. She is phenomenal. We're flying her down from Joburg, and she's going to be speaking into the life of our church. I promise you, you don't want to miss out. Don't let your family miss out either. But we are really serious about investing into the life of our church in this area of your life. But making sure that when your relationships are flourishing, how many people know life is good? Now, raise your hand. Marriage is a blessing when marriage is a blessing. Raise your hand. Say amen. And marriage is also not a blessing, don't raise your hand now, when it's not a blessing. The Bible says something similar, okay? The Bible, I just want to go to the Word of God. I don't want to bring the Word into everything, but maybe this one time. It's a bad joke. Damn it. It tanked. Second service won't get that guy. Proverbs 18:22 says this: the man who finds a wife finds a treasure. Come on now. He receives favor from the Lord. Some wives need to remind their husbands, you are highly favored right now. Yeah, they forgot. Your husbands have forgotten that they're highly favored. Mm-hmm. What a man, what a man, what a man, what a mighty good man. Yes, he is. I don't want no scrubs. A scrub is if I can't get no. Find some favor. I told you we're going to have a good time this series, did I not? We're going to have a good old time. Finds favor of the Lord. Another translation says, finds a good thing, a very good thing. But it also says, conversely so. I mean, I'm just assuming the Bible was just saying that when a woman finds a husband, come on now. She finds, come on now. She's got to, finds a good thing. Some of the husbands just remind the wives. Borscht 8. Just got to get the pics there. Says, Proverbs 27:15, a quarrelsome wife is as annoying. What? As a constant dripping on a rainy day. Isn't it dropping like 9 mils of rain today or something? On a what? Woo! I hit you with another scripture or a reference that's on my iPad. It's not actually scripture, but it probably should be. It's better to pass a kidney stone than to be married with a self-centered narcissistic jerk. Come on, that's 1 Dino 4 verse 9. 1 Dino 4 9, SBIB, should be in the Bible. So I'm not just going to be picking on everyone today. It doesn't mean you're getting picked on today. You're getting picked on today. So we're gonna have a good old time this morning. I love this series. I've been looking forward to the series since last year. So I've been preparing for this series. I'm so glad that you guys are here to receive it. So we've got one objective this morning. And that objective is just to define real quick the 2-3 hours that we have together today, just really quickly to define what is Christian marriage? What is Christian marriage? And I put the emphasis on Christian because the Bible describes marriage very differently from the way the world describes marriage. And it's very important that you and I, as followers of Christ, make that distinction between what Christian marriage is and what the world says marriage is. There's a big difference. And so what we're going to do today is we're going to teach from the Word of God what followers of Christ believe about Christian marriage. And so we're going to find out what Jesus says about Christian marriage from the outset. Matthew chapter 19, verse 4 to 6. It says, "Haven't you read?" So Jesus assumed they did. "That at the beginning, the Creator made them male and female and said, 'For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united with his wife. The two will become one flesh, so there will no longer be two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate.'" You see, the way that we understand marriage shapes the way we approach relationships. How you define Christian marriage or marriage at all will shape how you approach relationships. So if you only believe that a marriage is a contract between two consenting adults, a piece of paper that keeps you together, you will approach the relationship very differently from the way the Bible describes it. From the outset, the Bible says that God made marriage. God created marriage. It was His design. It was His idea. If it's His design, He gets to tell us how it should be done as Christians. Now, I'm not saying if you're not a Christian, this doesn't apply to you. This is not your first step. Your first step is Jesus. It's not the absence of sin, but the presence of Christ. And so your first step is not this. This isn't meeting the standard before you've accepted the Savior. This isn't passing the test before you've met the teacher. That's not your first step. If you're a Christian, this is your next step. To follow His design, marriage was His idea. He says the two become one. This is maths in the world. Half plus half equals one. But that's not the maths in the kingdom. The kingdom math says relationally one plus one equals one. It's not half and half. It's one and one. One whole person in Jesus plus another whole person in Christ equals one whole person in marriage. That's what Christians believe about Christian marriage. We're going to believe for healing, equipping, and preparing. Are you with me this morning? This is how the Lord, and it says, what the Lord has brought together. Remember, in a Christian marriage, there aren't two people. There are three. In fact, if you want to do five, that's a lot of people. You didn't know that you're saying, I know. When I said yes, then I met the other four personalities. I'm not joking. That's it. Something else there. So. That's for the spouse. That's not for you. That's if it's the spouse. It's yourself, your spouse, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. That's the five people. And so we see that this was the Lord's idea. So if you see it's a contract between two consenting adults, maybe you went to a church and you had a pastor stand in front, or maybe you eloped and went to Vegas and you found Elvis. You know, maybe that's, you'll approach relationships very, very differently, profoundly differently. If you see it as a contract, what is a contract? I'm so glad you asked. It's great. A contract is based on mutual mistrust. So what do you do when you contract someone to redo the floors in your house, Ryan, as he just recently done because he had a leak? Shame, we're praying for him. He is terrible. Ryan's a little OCD. I don't know if you know this. So like when anything's out, he's just like, they ripped up all of his floors. I secretly enjoyed it because Ryan is like, but he got a contractor in. He made him sign a contract. And what does a contract do? This is what a contract does. A contract protects your rights, but limits your responsibilities. If you believe that marriage is just a contract, what you're doing is protecting your rights and limiting your responsibilities. If you do this and I do this, then I'm in. If you don't, then I'm out. It's very different from Christian marriage. But I want to say this. If you believe that marriage is just a piece of paper, I'm going to be honest with you, that, like, for real, I would not get married. Like, if I wasn't a Christian, okay, the amen was a bit strong there. But that's a bit of strong amen. I don't know if someone's offended there. It's like, amen. But I'm saying, like, if I wasn't a follower of Christ, I don't know what the point of marriage is because it's just a contract then. I would have been staying with you anyway. And it sounds like a decent plan for real. I'm like moving together, split the bills, share the Netflix. Like, split the chores, share the blessings. I'm like, it sounds like a pretty good deal. But if you if you take a look at the studies, secular studies, not Christian studies, because sometimes Christian studies are evangelistic. Secular studies show us that actually people who live together before they get married in the world, not in the church, actually have less of a chance of relational success. And you ask me the question, why? I'm so glad you asked. Again. But I understand it. Test the milk before you buy the cow, eh? No? Someone once said that. This is why. It puts more pressure on. This is why it doesn't work out too often of the time. It's because you are fully entangled, but not fully committed. It's fully entangled, but not fully committed. So we move in together. We split the bills. It's, you know, you do the wash, I do the wash. That's good. Then we get a dog. Who cleans after the dog? Tells you a lot. Just watch that. The dog turns into a child. Okay, well, it doesn't actually turn into the child. The dog doesn't become a child. We're not preaching that. Don't say, oh, yeah, what I learned at church is they believe that dogs turn into children. Although some dogs are, like, better treated than children. Like, I'm going to be honest with you, I have a picture of my dog as my screensaver, not my children. Anyways, her name's Spicy. She's wonderful. Groot is whatever, but Spicy. We all have a favorite, don't we? That's another sermon altogether. That's the family series coming up later this year in July. How not to be favorites. But you're fully entangled, but not fully committed. And what that does is it adds more pressure because you feel stuck. So you play house, you play marriage, and then it doesn't work up. You break up, and what do? You play divorce. You actually practice how to get out of it. It's like your world is being torn apart. Am I making any sense here? So I'm saying, like, if I wasn't a follower of Jesus, I don't think I would get married. Because what, I would have done this stuff anyway. It's just a contract. Now it's just a legal binding thing. I'm like, it's just enmeshed. But if I'm a Christian, if I'm following the Lord, if Jesus is my Savior and leader, and I want my best for Him, this is a good question to ask yourself. You say, is this God's best for me? And is my life pleasing to Him? With business, with family, with finance, with everything, is this God's best for me? And is my life pleasing to Him? You see, in the Bible, it teaches us how to live by His design. But then there's some areas where He doesn't really mention. Like, it's sort of like there's gray areas. Hey, it's like, you know, and how do we, you know how you answer that gray area? Is this God's best for me? And is this pleasing to Him? It doesn't actually say that in the Bible right there that you can't live together. Doesn't it? I don't read that in the Bible. It says be pure, but it doesn't say you can't live together as a Christian. Well, just ask yourself, is this God's best for me? And is what I'm doing right now pleasing to Him? Is this okay? I said I want to be really clear because I want to be kind. I want God's best for your life. Absolute best. I'm not going to practice in order to get married. I'm going to save myself to prepare for when I am in Christian marriage. So as we talk about marriage, talk about married things, it's maybe PG-13 coming up. Just letting you know, just checking the crowd. Checking the crowd. There we go. PG-13. The team can come up over here. We see that marriage in Christianity from the Bible is not a contract. It's a covenant. A covenant is very different. A covenant is based on mutual commitment, not mutual distrust. A covenant back in the day, what they would do is if you were going to do business with someone, you would cut a cow in half. And you would walk through the middle, both of you would walk through the middle of the cow 7 times, through the middle. And what you agree upon, it was a bit of spit in the hand, I'm sure, like, I don't know how they did it. But obviously, they didn't have COVID back then. Like, otherwise, we would all be doing this. It's like, I don't know. That's why I'm not a businessman. They would walk through the middle of the cow, both of them, 7 times, and shake hands and say, if I break this covenant, you can do to me what we did this to this cow. That's a high level of commitment. That's like a whole nother level. That's a big difference between just a piece of paper where that's a little bit of ink. You're saying, if I break my commitment to you, do what we just did to this cow. We cut it in half. I'm as good at it. That's why it's so crazy, but to follow people and take them at their word is so few and far between these days, hey? And you have to have a contract about everything. And I'm saying, actually, you do. When you're working with people in the world and with just any other people, just get a contract. I'm just saying, in the church, some, you know, anyway, moving forward. We don't slaughter cows, otherwise it'd just be like, you know, just cows everywhere. Everyone's making covenants and... But it's a covenant, it's not a contract. The two become one. God joins together. It's not 50-50, it's 100-100. You know, Hebrews says this. Hebrews says that marriage should be honored by all. So marriage should not be honored by married people only. It shouldn't be just married. You know, I just want to say that when you're married, you haven't arrived. Like some single people are like, oh, I just can't wait till I'm married. And that's a good desire. Like when I'm married, then I arrive. Oh, Lord, help me, Jesus. I just realized how far back I was. When I got married, I just realized that, geez, I'm just way further back than what I thought. I'm saying, like, you think, oh, my life's going to begin one day when I'm married. No, in Jesus' name. Your life begins today. A brand new mercy every single day. So it's not living in one day when. I'm living in right now. I'm saying I have a destiny right now. And one day when you get married, that's God's will for your life. It's not a contract. As a Christian, it's a covenant. It's a covenant between you, someone else, and God. And saying, Lord, you are in the middle of this all. Christian marriage doesn't work without Christ. It's just you, your spouse, and Ian. You take Christ out of Christian. No, second service won't get that guy either. Don't worry. Thank you for being the come on now. God must be in the middle of Christian marriage. He must be in the middle of it. He must be the goal. How you see marriage shapes how you approach relationships. So while we're talking about marriage, how do we talk about sexual integrity in a culture of celebrated sexual brokenness? How do we talk about that? Like, what do we say? Dino, that's too hectic. That's old school. That's so extreme. That's so abnormal. Remember, we don't want normal. I don't want normal. You don't want normal. God doesn't want normal for you. I remember when I first gave my heart to the Lord. So funny that I actually have one of my view group guys here. When my very first view group I ever launched, Hope was in it. He's sitting over there. He lives in Joburg. So we pray for him, Shame. He came down to see what heaven might be like. He flew down just for the weekend. Like, oh, wow, this is so nice. No potholes. Shame, he was just driving. He just rode straight. It's like, wow, this is amazing. My very first view group, I was a terrible view group leader. But that's okay. That's neither here nor there. When I first gave my heart to the Lord, I asked my youth pastor, as you should ask your youth pastor, which is Ryan over here, all tough and difficult questions. All of them. Just Google all difficult questions you can ask Ryan. And I asked Andre. I said, Andre, okay, cool. So now that I'm a Christian, like, how do we date? How do I date? How do I date? You know, I was dating someone back then. How do I date this girl? And Andre says, well, the Bible teaches us that we are supposed to treat each other before marriage like brothers and sisters. I said, you're sick. I said after that you're sick. That's where I draw the line. I knew this Christian thing was just, come on now. Come on now. Come on, Andre. I said, treat each other like brothers and sisters. He said, what do you do with your brother and sister? I said, well, I watch movies. I tease her. I burn her Barbies. I don't know. He's like, well, do the same. I said, my girlfriend doesn't have Barbies. I'm 15. He said this. He said, okay, let me ask you another question. Would you want anyone to kiss or touch your wife? I said, someone touches my wife, I help them meet the Lord that day. That day they go meet the Lord. They will be in paradise. Anyone touches my, just someone looks at my wife. Hello. I just take off the oil. He says, okay. So you want no one touching your wife. Okay. But before you married, everyone is someone else's potential husband and wife. And if the Bible says you reap what you sow, if you want to have someone who saved all their hugs and kisses for you, shouldn't you save all your hugs and kisses for them? And I thought, wow, I'm not waiting. I'm preparing. I'm not waiting. I'm preparing. He says, Dino, you need to build and construct a relational bank account. And one day when you walk to the altar, you want to go to the altar and say, you know what? Look how much I saved for you. Not look how much I spent on others. This is what God's best is for you. God's going to heal you from where you've been. Because when I heard the sermon, all I felt was guilt and shame. All I felt was guilt and shame. But that's not the gospel. God's going to heal you from where you've been. He's going to equip you for where you are. And he's going to prepare you for where you go. As Christian marriage, it's not a contract. It's a covenant. It's a holy. You know what the enemy does? He takes something so pure and holy and he makes it common. And he says, oh, it's just everyone's doing. Just, you know, everyone treats people like this. So it's just, no, it's holy. It's special. It's sacred. It's God's best. Is this God's best for my life? And is this pleasing to him? He's going to heal me. He's going to equip me. He's going to prepare me. we want the best for your marriage. We want the best for your future. Whatever your relational status is, I believe God's going to do these three things in your life. If you would open the door of your heart, I believe God can do something special. So then, when Andre shared this with me, I cried. I said, Andre, what? I said, what about if I've already given away some of my hugs and kisses? He says, that's why Jesus doesn't make you better. He said, that's why Jesus makes you new. He doesn't make you better. He makes you new. And that's when I realized, no, shame's not part of my life anymore. And it's a journey. Because we're all people and we're all human. That's why we need Jesus. It's not like I want Jesus. Like, we need Jesus to make us new. It's not like, hey, make me better. No, I need you to make me new every day. I need your forgiveness. We broke bread together. I thought that was a beautiful moment where we just, thank you, Jesus. You don't make me better. You make me new. So that when I step into the next season, or you know what? You need a new fresh start in your singleness. You need a new fresh start in your dating. You're actually going to agree with your girlfriend now. We're going to date differently now. From today on, we're dating differently. In your married life, you need a fresh start. We're going to be married differently. It didn't work out. It didn't work out. And that marriage ended. I promise you, God's got a fresh start for you. He's got healing for your past. He's got equipment for your present. And he's got preparation for your future. I'm believing God to do this great, these three great things in your life in this series. Can you believe with me today? So I want us to stand to our feet. We're going to worship God together. And as we do, I want you to ask yourself that question. Is this God's best for my life? And is this pleasing to him? Is this God's best for my life? What do we know about marriage? Marriage is not a contract. It's a covenant. What do we know about marriage? Marriage is not 50-50. It's 100-100. What do we know about marriage? God brings people together. What do we know about our Lord? He saves, he heals, he redeems, he makes new. What do we know about our Father? He looks from afar off when you come home, and when he comes home, he celebrates the fact that you're in his house. What do we know about the gospel? There's no guilt or condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, for the new has come and the old is gone. What do we know about the Word of God? It's alive, it is powerful, it is moving, and if you would receive it, he can bring healing in your life. He can give you some tools for the present, and he can prepare you for the best future ever. Come on, let's sing out to God today as we lift our hearts before the Lord. Do what only you can. Say the Lord has never been unaware of you. He's always been aware of you. So I want to pray for every relational season you're in right now. I'm praying this month of March, God's going to do a great miracle in your life. An absolute miracle. So I want to pray if you're in this, you're single and ready to mingle. Come on, somebody, you got to stay in that connect area. Got into your view group, raise that left hand, put that anointing oil on, get those highlighters out. But I'm praying you receive this word. You're not waiting. Your destiny is unfolding. You're preparing. God wants to use you in a mighty way right now. You don't arrive in that season. You steward this one. God's placed you here for a purpose. You have destiny. Your value is not found in someone else. Your value is not found when you have someone else. Your value is intrinsic because you have Jesus and Jesus has you. Lord, I lift every person in that season right now, God, and I thank you, Lord. We don't need someone to complete us. We have our Savior. And God, when you bring that person, Lord, we thank you, Lord, that you'll align our footsteps and they're going to love you. They're going to follow you. They're going to give their best for you and to you, Lord, and we'll do the same in the meantime, God. But I thank you, we're not waiting. We're not waiting. We're not stagnant. We're moving, we're growing, we're building, we're preparing, we're saving, because we know that your best is better than ours. I pray for people that are dating right now, Lord, that you would give them a fresh start to the way they date. Right now in Jesus' name, they would have a holy conviction. God, I just, right now, no guilt, no shame, no condemnation. That's not from Jesus. That's not from God. That's the enemy trying to bring you down. But I do pray for a holy revelation right now. About your best, what's your best for me, and is this pleasing to you? I pray that when we date someone, Lord, that we would treat them with honor, we would protect their hearts, we would protect their minds, we would put them ahead of our own selves, our own agendas, Lord. We would think about their future, Lord, and we wouldn't, yeah, God, we would just take care of their hearts, Lord, as you take care of ours. I pray for people that are preparing to get married. Come on, Jesus. We pray for money for that wedding because it's expensive. Come on now. If you're in there, come on now. Tell the truth and shame the devil. I pray, Lord, that you would absolutely build them stronger as they move towards the altar. I pray that you would help them, Lord, in their next steps. And I pray for every married couple, Lord. Every single one. Your hand would be upon their marriage. It's not a contract. It's a covenant. Your hand is upon them. Lord, I'm praying for couples that are believing for a new start. They're married, but they want a new marriage. You can do that. You can give them a new marriage, Lord. As they say, I'm building on something. I'm building on a new foundation. I'm not building on just the past. I'm building on who Jesus is today for me in the Word of God. And I pray for a new start, even in an old marriage. I'm praying for a fresh breath of heaven and a vitality and a dynamism. And I pray that they fall more in love. God, I pray for anyone who the wedding day was the highest point in their relationship. God, I pray it was a high point, but not the highest. I pray they would see greater heights and more, fall more in love. And they would feel more passionate and feel more committed to their spouse than ever before. I pray they wake up tomorrow morning and say, hey, whoa, 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 whoa. Who am I? Like, hello. Come on, somebody. Pray blessing on their homes and on their marriage. I want to lift anyone up right now, Lord, that it didn't work out. It didn't work out the way they thought it was going to work out. God, I pray for healing. I pray for equipping. I pray for preparing. I want to say, Lord, your Bible that we believe in, your word, says that it's not the end. Lord, that their life is not over. You still have destiny ahead of them. I pray you would take all the lies of the enemy, of their value, you take all the lies of the enemy, all those things that he jabs at, you You remove them from them. You replace it with your truth. And they'll continue to believe. They've stopped believing. They've stopped hoping. God, that you would absolutely do a fresh work in their hearts. If you're standing here today and you're saying, Dino, I need Jesus in my life right now. I don't have him. I know I need to start a relationship with him for myself. Not because of where I grew up, not because of where I live, not because of any of these things, but I know that I know that I know that I need to start a relationship with Christ, and I want him as my Lord and Savior. Then at the tip of Africa in a school hall in the northern suburbs with every eye closed, you're saying, Dino, that's me. I need this grace. I need this forgiveness. I don't need to be made better. I need to be made new. And I'll understand it's only through Christ that that is possible. If that's you, I want you to, and you want to give your heart to the Lord, raise your hand right now saying, Dino, that's me. I'm giving my heart to the Lord. That's awesome. That's awesome. That's awesome. So good. You're saying, Dino, that's me. Raise your hand. Take it back down. It's not about me seeing your hand. It's not about me seeing your hand. It's about the Lord seeing your life. And we're going to pray from front to back, side to side right now. And all everyone pray with me. The Bible says, believe in your heart and confess with your mouth and you'll be saved. So we're going to pray together today as a church, as a family of faith. Follow me as I lead you in prayer. Father God, I thank you for sending your one and only Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for my sins. I confess I'm a sinner. I need a Savior. Come into my life. Come into my world. Wash me clean. Forgive me, Lord, and make me new. And I promise to worship you and serve you all the days of my life. In Jesus' precious name. And all God's people said, can we celebrate with some people today? Come on, somebody. We can do better than that. Some people gave their hearts to the Lord. So good. Well, if you did give your heart to the Lord, or if you prayed that prayer and you didn't raise your hand, that's okay. We've got a wonderful team after the service. There's a little sign you're saying we'll pray with you. But we would love to give you the free gift of God's Word. You can go to our website as well. We've got a course called the Following Jesus Course. You can do that in your own time. It's going to teach you how to follow Christ, take your next steps.